Good morning. Happy Thanksgiving. Not really sure what the appropriate response is to that. Usually it's just to say Happy Thanksgiving back, right? But even that is not so much perceived as a greeting. I wasn't trying to put you on the spot. Today we are here to do something very simple, but very profound. Thank the Lord for all of his goodness to us, his physical blessings and his spiritual blessings. This is the kind of thing where if you stop and just think about it, it can be overwhelming. That said, we're going to try to do it anyway, to thank God for his goodness to us. We'll begin with our first hymn, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. When we get to the fourth stanza, please stand. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. I will praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you established your faithfulness in heaven itself. Praise to the Lord, O let all that is in me adore him. All that has life and breath, come now with praises before him. Let the Amen sound from his people again. Gladly forever adore him. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Father, your generous goodness comes to us new every day. By the work of your Spirit, lead us to acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. A reading from Philippians chapter 4. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out for Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you only. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. Not that I am looking for a gift, but I am looking for what may be credited to your account. I have received full payment and even more. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gift you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. And my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm of the day is Psalm 136, the psalm that we get the common table prayer from. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. We'll sing the psalm together.
Bless you now with one accord. Your love is everlasting. You, Lord, alone did wondrous deeds. Your mercy lives forever. From you alone all good proceeds. Your love will keep us ever. Your wisdom made the heavens to be. You formed the earth above the sea. Your love is everlasting. You rescue us from every foe. Your mercy lives forever. You feed your creatures here below. Your love will keep us ever. We give you thanks, Creator Lord. We sing the glories of your word. Your love is everlasting.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Gospel for Thanksgiving Day is from Luke chapter 17. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Please be seated. The hymn of the day is "Come, You Thankful People, Come." We'll sing it along with the choir.
Thank you.
O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Amen. Happy Thanksgiving again. There you go. You were ready this time. Of course, a happy Thanksgiving today means that Black Friday is right around the corner. And that is dangerous. Because I never knew how pathetic my cell phone was until I saw the deals on the new iPhone 13. And I had forgotten how few good dress shirts I had until I read about the doorbusters at Kohl's. That ever happened to you? You think that everything is okay, and then the mall gets to you, or Best Buy gets to you, or Cabela's gets to you, or the commercials get to you. You may have a family van, but does it have dual climate control for your wife who's always freezing? Your daughter may have shoes, but do they light up and have all the Disney princesses on them? You may have unlimited talk and text, but do you have unlimited data? And without even thinking about it, our vocabulary makes that subtle shift from "I'd like that" to "I need that." But what do you expect? You hear 10,001 sermons every week from the devil, the world, and your own sinful flesh about what you need to be happy, pushing you into a life of discontent. Oh, Pastor, come on, not this again. Lighten up. It's a holiday. What does any of that have to do with Thanksgiving? Everything. Thanksgiving flows from being content. Hell flows from being discontent. The devil has been using discontent to drive a wedge between God and man ever since he convinced Adam and Eve that all they really needed to be happy was a bite from the forbidden fruit. But contentment is not getting what you want. Contentment is wanting what you've got. You're thankful for what you do have, not upset about what you don't have. And God wants you always to be content, not just on Thanksgiving Day, but every day. God wants you to be thankful always, not just when you are stuffed with turkey and sleeping on the couch, but all the time. So this morning, the Apostle Paul teaches you the secret of being content. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. Did you hear that? That is crazy. Paul writes this from prison. In fact, when he writes this, he has been imprisoned for almost 5 years. He's in Rome waiting for his trial. He is, as he says at the start of this letter, in chains for Christ. His only crime is telling people about Christ and death, execution, the parting of his head from his body is a very real possibility. For doing the right thing, for proclaiming Christ, for this he could die. But how does he feel? I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. How? Paul, your life is so unfair. You don't have a home. You don't have your books. You can't do your mission work, and the food there must be terrible. You don't have enough to be content. But he is. It's like Paul is living in some sort of parallel universe where up is down, down is up, and he has no reason to do anything but rejoice. For Paul, every day is Thanksgiving Day, no matter what. So what's the deal? Is he just wired differently than we are? Does he have some kind of special gift to be okay with less? No. Listen to what he says. I have learned to be content. And again, I have learned the secret of being content. Paul learned it. Someone taught him how to be okay with what he had. And once he learned that secret, he could be content in any and every situation. Whether he was sitting down to feast or eating prison rations, whether sleeping on a big comfy bed or napping shackled to a guard, Paul's contentment is completely independent of what he has, where he is, and how he lives. So what's the secret? What's the secret of being content? What do we need to learn to be content in any and every situation? Paul buries his answer at the very end of the reading. My God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. The secret of being content is believing that God is the provider. God will give you exactly what you need. God will provide plenty when you need it. God will let you be in need when you need it. God will always provide exactly what you need at exactly the right time. That's the secret of being content. It's a secret because it's not something that comes naturally. God has to teach it to you. And even after we learn it, few of us can live it. Right? You always want to believe that you need more to be happy, or something different to be happy, or someone different. You think that you'll only be happy when you get this, or when you finally earn enough for that, and when you work there, and when you live here. Envy and jealousy and worry and fear all surround this false notion that God does not provide. But once you know the secret, God does provide, then those things disappear. God gives you everything you need right now. Paul believes that. And that makes him content at his richest and at his poorest. But getting that attitude was not easy. Paul confesses, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Paul can cope with any and every situation only because Jesus gives him the strength to do so. And it takes God-given strength to be content just with what you need. And you caught that, right? God promises to provide everything you need, not everything you want. The problem is that when your needs are met, that's when you pine after what you want. And it all shows you what a risk God takes every time he provides. a risk that we will take the gift, wait for more, and forget the giver. Right? On Thanksgiving, Jesus heals 10 men with leprosy and gets one thank you. On Good Friday, he goes to the cross for the sins of the world. How many people shout thank you to him then? None. They shout, crucify him. Jesus is slandered, mocked, abused, beaten, whipped, stripped, crucified, and forgotten. But he never stops giving. Jesus does not stop providing just because most people forget him. He came to meet our greatest need, forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. Our discontent is nailed to the cross with him. Our forgetfulness lies forgotten in his empty tomb. And you have everything that you need. Jesus lived for you. Jesus died for you. Jesus rose for you. You are forgiven. That is the only thing you truly need, and you have it. Knowing the difference between that one thing that you really need and all the stuff that you really want is critical for being content. Because all of your earthly blessings are just that. Earthly, as awesome as they are. But they're good only for today. Only for your time on earth. But when you die, the one blessing that really matters is forgiveness in Christ. That blessing is the difference between hell and heaven. That blessing goes with you beyond the grave and into eternity. Now, when you know the secret of being content, God changes you. Jesus once said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." And when you're content, you'll live that. You'll have more fun giving stuff than getting it. And maybe you think that's crazy. Maybe you think it's more blessed to get than to give. But look here, because the Philippians understand this. God blesses them, and they want to be a blessing to others. They're concerned because Paul is in prison, so they help him. He says, "It was good of you to share in my troubles. Even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God." The more generous you are, the more content you become. It sounds backwards, but it's true. Because it seems like if we bought more, had more, and saved more, we'd be more content. But that never seems to work. In fact, it usually just makes you less content. So be generous. Be content. Then when God gives you a lot, you can enjoy it without needing more. And when God gives you little, you can be okay with it and not need more. Because you are content. You can sit down today before your Thanksgiving dinner and pray, "Lord God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for forgiveness. And thank you for everything else." It doesn't matter if everything else is many things or few things. You'll be happy with God just for meeting all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please stand for prayer. We praise and thank you, gracious Lord, for your indescribable gift, our Savior Jesus Christ, who has redeemed us from sin, death, and the power of the devil, that we might be your own and live in your kingdom forever.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare to make no other claim but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
We praise and thank you, gracious Lord, for the gift of your word and sacraments, through which you give us faith in your Son and the desire to serve you in all we say and do.
Your little flock, your name alone confessing, continue in your loving care, true unity possessing, your sacraments, O Lord, and your saving word to us e'er pure retain, grant that they may remain our only strength and comfort.
We praise and thank you, gracious Lord, for the gift of life and health and the abundance of our earthly blessings.
Let all things now living a song of thanksgiving to God the Creator triumphantly raise, who fashioned and made us, protected and stayed us, who still guides us on to the end of our days. God's banners are o'er us, his light goes before us, a pillar of fire shining forth in the night, till shadows have vanished and darkness is banished, as forward we travel from light into light.
We praise and thank you, gracious Lord, for the comfort you give us when our hearts are heavy and troubles overwhelm us.
If God himself be for me, I may a host defy. For when I pray before me, my foes confounded fly. If Christ my head and master befriend me from above, what foe or what disaster can drive me from his love?
We praise and thank you, gracious Lord, for the victory you have given to our friends and loved ones who have died and now live with you in glory.
Amen. us be forever blessed. Alleluia. Alleluia.
We praise and thank you, gracious Lord, for growing your kingdom and leading many more to know you and love you.
Lord, gather all your children wherever they may be, and lead them unto heaven to live eternally. With you, our loving Father, and Christ, our brother dear, whose Spirit guards and gives us the joy to persevere.
For all your gifts, gracious Lord, for your blessings to body and soul that are new to us every morning, we praise and thank you, now and always.
From all that dwell below the skies, let the Creator's praise arise. Alleluia, alleluia. Let the Redeemer's name be sung through every land in every tongue. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of righteousness. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated to sing the closing hymn.
And hands and voices, who wondrous things has done, in whom his world rejoices, who from our mother's arms has blessed us on our way with countless gifts of love. God, through all our life be near us, with ever joyful hearts and blessed peace to cheer us, and keep us in his grace, and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. All praise and thanks to God, the Father, now be given. given, the Son and Him who reigns with them in highest heaven, the one eternal God, whom earth and heaven adore, for thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore.
Hi. I know what you're thinking. Thank God my parents did not name me Epaphroditus. No, that's not what you're thinking. You're thinking, thank God church was only 44 minutes this morning. No, you're not thinking that. What you're really thinking is, I'm so thankful that I'm done singing. Okay. But how do you thank God? It's kind of like it's coming up on Christmas. What do you get the person who has everything? What do you get God? He has everything. How do you thank Him? Well, the Bible makes it pretty clear that the way you thank God is by speaking and singing back to Him the wonderful things He has done. Not because He needs an ego boost, but because when you do that, you're speaking and singing the things of God to one another. So I'm thankful today that you were here so I could preach the gospel to you. And I'm also thankful that you're here this morning so that you could preach the gospel to me by the words from the Bible you spoke and by the words from the Bible you sung. Those are all the announcements I have. Happy Thanksgiving. I will usher you out. God bless the rest of your week.